Okay, Tony, thank you. Richard, can you hear me now? Is that all right? If you don't, you can wave at me and I'll do something about it. I've got to remember to move the slides on, so if I'm not, move the slides on. Shout. Move the slides on. Can you hear me in the back?
You need to speak properly. Put your sound in the glasses.
Sorry. I hate talking into the microphone.
Yeah, I know, just do it.
Which says a lot, I think, about what
But this is what you like to grow alongside the distance of your writing. And many of the first wave of disabled artists call themselves immersed in my politics, that disability and me included. So it came as a shock for me to realise that for the last 30 years I've been involved in this disability arts and marketing. And it's only proper then that we start having glorious black and white. So this piece was one of the three pieces that showed in our bar, some of it's called Six Circles, made in 1989. A lot of my early work was about reintegration. So this is a tree trunk that was cut down because of the Chagas disease at the time. And I wanted to reintegrate the tree trunk, and the way I chose to do that was to cut an arc into the five slices of tree trunk. And the arc then, if you look at it, your brain sort of connected all, and the arc reintegrates the five pieces of wood. And I did that with a number of pieces. I'm mostly using timber and lead. I also exhibited this piece, which was called Springback. And this was described, I think, by Adam Reynolds, who wrote quite a lot about disability arts in various weekends. He described it as a self-portrait, my self-portrait. And it's an assemblage. It's my spine x-ray. I don't know if you can see it in that picture, but there's four springs which were inserted by surgery to have a motor accident. And so the springs were to hold my spine together. I don't know if you can see them on that picture from there, if you can. If not, you can probably see it on my website. So it's an x-ray. It's some bulldog clips holding it to a piece of clip, that's the perspective. And the springs at the bottom of the motorcycle suspension unit. So it's kind of tied to report to me. Spring back could be spring back to life, or it could be about me springs in my back. And I need the x-ray from the hospital.
wheeled in with a prosthetic leg with a big Doc Martin boot. here in the audience, and they were filming it at the BBC. So we took some stills off the BBC. This is made from 1,760 red charity photographs. When I wanted to price these, there was only one place to buy them from. And we ran up and said, can you loan us the cans? And the firm said, no, we can sell you the cans. And I said, okay, can you sell me a discount? No, 1,760 cans. And they said, no, we can't. We can sell them you at full price. So again, it tells you another very interesting story about this and charity and and I should say thank you to Sarah Scott, who was the Disability Arts Officer at the Arts Council in those days, because in those days the Arts Council actually did actively promote disability and disability arts. And Sean Fersey at LDAF, who was, I think, the director of LDAF, who helped to fund and promote this work. And that's what it looks like now. That's the sort of colour photograph. And that's what it looked like at the Richard Attenborough Centre for Contemporary Art in Leicester, who's had a recent exhibition called Art, Life and Activism. Okay, this piece is called Reverend from a Wheelchair. Again, it's about referencing impairment and objects that have or are used disability. When I was 37 in 1970, you had a choice of two wheelchairs, an Everson Jennings or a Besser. And I went to the Artificial Limb and Pine Centre and said, can I have a couple of old condemned wheelchairs? And they freely gave me these two wheelchairs. I took them to bits and I reassembled them in my studio to make this map, outline map, Great Britain. And my rule was that I couldn't use anything that wasn't in this pile of bits of old wheelchairs. I used to get all my stuff for the old days from Armagh. The false leg I threw into the pyramid of Jasper Cast. I got somebody's name in my felt pen. In a very strange and very strange world, it had access to all these old bits, different old disabilities of people's nature. Anyway, this piece is in the Grey Eye building in London on Heaton the Road, if you know Grey Eye. Grey Eye is near the Jetty Museum. I'm sure if you want to nice it, you can go in and have a look at it if you want to. This piece is called Split. It's a wood carving from 1995, and a wood turn gave this and said, this piece of ash is not good, it's got a shape in it. I don't know whether you want it. So it changed the slit in the wood, and I lived in my studio for about a year, wondering what the hell I was going to do with it. And what I really knew I wanted to do was not split it at all. And suddenly all of a sudden it appeared in my head, like, why don't I just carve the word slit into it and use the slit as the letter I. So the I is both about person, the person I, and the absence or the deficit, I guess we talk about in disability terms. So the deficit, which you know, would non-disabled people see as negative, is absolutely positive in this work. Because without the deficit, work wouldn't exist. I made a meal of telling you that. I don't know whether that makes sense. This Barbara keeps cropping up in my work today, but this piece is called White on White. And it's subtitled Barbara Johnny and the Quiet Revolution. So it is.
Good job I'm here there.
It is, yeah. So the work, it really concerns British Sign Language. Because British Sign Language was not recognised officially as a language, which I thought was appalling bad. And when I was at school, I could learn French or German, but I couldn't learn British Sign Language. And if I'd learned British Sign Language, it would have empowered me much more. This piece of work is featured in Pally Mayfield's book, Strength, Broadside from Disability on the Arts. And it's quite an interesting work if you've never somebody picked up a car on Grace and Grace had a look at it, couldn't believe whether there were bricks or not, but whether it was lifted brick. And of course the invigilator screamed and put it down, terrified the first. And then suddenly somebody with white gloves came to lift up this house brick and put it back amongst our house bricks, which is, you know, just totally pretentious and awful. So the starting point was that Owen wore a song, which was lodged in my subconscious. And Barbara and I said it, and we're about it. And it is about Barbara and Johnny being oppressed by, I think, a Sussex Society school. And so the gloves spell out smile in the top line, and they spell out fuck in the bottom line. And so fuck. Even if you have to say
quietly. They turned the mics off on us when we started swearing at this kid. They said, have a language like that.
Notice my microphone off there. But interestingly, two delegates who wanted to show this, when they realised what it said, they wanted to show it on the grounds that it was indecent or offensive. And there was a big girl who had to think that art was supposed to be games.
Yeah.
Here we go. So this piece is called Sentiment. It's carved from Carrara marble. It's a miracle of two fat naked blokes sat on a bench. And you might notice that the bench doesn't have any legs. So how that's why it's a miracle. So the bench hasn't collapsed yet. I used to, when I was younger, I used to just whisk past all the steps of marble and from, you know, classical antiquity, because I just didn't think they were interesting. And the minute I started to carve stone and marble, I suddenly realised how difficult it was to be in the 15th, 16th, 17th century. No electric light, no power tools, no diamond sanders, no tungsten tools to cut. And you know, those, I look at that work again now, it's absolutely amazing. This piece is called Certain Form. And it's a piece that I made following a conversation with an artist who was slowly going blind. And he talked about his encroaching blindness as being like a snake moving through space, in that you could actually really see the snake moving through space, but you knew it was moving. And he was sort of saying, I can't remember how much vision I had a year ago, 6 months ago, because of this sort of certain like blindness that is slowly increasing. And so I carved this work, which is a certain like form. It pierces the eyeball on the what is it called? The eye anyway. But also, you may notice on that, this side on the left, that the marble is carved very thinly, so you can see this very white, milky line that comes through. And when you actually see the marble, it's got very faint veins in it, which is kind of like when the optician puts the line in your eyes and you see the one faint thing that's going on. So that's what that piece is about. And this is another carving from Carrara marble, and it's called Loop, but it's a giant hole on it, and it plays around with this idea of things not always being what they seem. So titles are important. The next piece is called Rearranged Penis, and it's a spine made out of porcelain clay, fired, and it's filled with paper clay to give it solidity. And those of you that are good at anagrams will realise that penis is an anagram of spine. You can work that out, because you are. Alright, this is a big piece in the public realm. This is called Square in the Circle, which is a kind of mathematical impossibility. It's about 25 feet across, it weighs about 13.5 tons, and it's carved from Portland stone. It's situated outside the School of Architecture at Portsmouth, and it's a reminder to architecture students about access. And it's about not being able to get to the centre of power. So, you know, we talk about the centre of power, and this sculpture is constructed in a way that stops you getting to the centre. Certainly if you were to use it, and you can see very little of it from my eyes. So this shot is taken from above it. You may be able to see that, again, the five disparate pieces of stone are linked by an arc. So it refers back to that early work from 1989, which was the cartridge one. And the square is constructed by the serrated edges, which you may be able to make out, which make up the square. And it's set on paving, which is made out of a circle and a white square, which you may, a black square and a white circle, which you might just be able to make out from this image. I walked in the middle of the night before we were putting this together because I've never seen it. It's never been put together. I carved these blocks separately in a quarry, and the people who laid the pavements were not me. And I suddenly, because it's quite millimeter, it needs to be millimeter perfect to all fit together, and it suddenly occurred to me that if something screwed up, it wouldn't fit together. So I was really terrified when we put it together. These are some details. But it wouldn't work, but it did line up. And to give us some humans. This particular piece. And I put some postcards out, which I put to have. So I'll put some postcards out each time if you want to take any of these. This piece is called Monuments and was intended for four groups for Paralympics in 2012. It was commissioned by Channel 4 Telly. And that's of course a pocket. So it occupies the big four, which is always outside the building, works very well. I don't know whether you know it in Westminster, just off Victoria Street. It's called Monuments and was intended for four because whilst it's for the Paralympics, but it's kind of subversive in the sense that it's not about celebrating Paralympians, it's about celebrating non-Paralympians, just ordinary disabled people who go about their daily business, but in doing so become objects of scrutiny, who are largely by non-disabled people. So when we get on a bus in a wheelchair and walk down the street with a wine tail, we are unintended performers all the time, we are subject to the gaze. And I think it was Linda Nocton who talked to about Ernest about the male gaze, and John Virgin were all very articulate about the male gaze, and about there's lots of women in art galleries, but they're usually naked and they're usually two-dimensional because they are paintings. And so it's about disabled people also being subject to the gaze. This is a nighttime shot. So there was quite a bit of neon in this piece. It's just over 50 feet tall. And it was nail biting but fun to make. This is another commission by the World Cup for the 2012 Games. And they asked me to recreate the work written in the wheelchair, which I showed you earlier. And they wanted me to make letters of Setco. And you can see Sekiro standing behind England and Wales, and Phil Craven, Sir Phil Craven, is sat behind Northern Ireland. So again, it's a recreation, but using sports wheelchairs this time to, and this is called Great Britain from a wheelchair we visited. And I always say truthfully, but ironically, that my work has been seen by the world, my audience, and millions. And nearly saw myself to tell lots of billions of people watched the Paralympic Games. Okay, so this is called You Laugh. And it's called You Laugh because I'm different about that, because you're all the same. And again, it's another piece of Corona model. It's five figures this time on the bench. And four figures facing one way and one figure facing the other way. Anybody wants to put it in the garden, and go. Alright, this is the final piece I'm going to show you. This is called Gold Larvae. Again, title's important, so it's play on the words name called Larvae. The old people in the audience, this is an English language. It's in the ubiquitous Saslu, because they were all done in Saslu, and I was given to one of these. I used to have a motorbike, and then I had a motorbike accident, and then I got one of these, and what the fuck am I going to do? Ride around this. So I did ride around, it was quite a lot of fun. A friend of mine, who I haven't seen for 40 years, said, do you remember I used to sit on the floor in that mad blue car you had? Only had a few years. And we used to drive around, get drunk, and hang the other side on the hill. That's probably true. So that's me work on it. This is it being hauled into place in the Luke Gallery in Liverpool. And this is the final bit of it. So it's all gold bar maze. It's gold. The number plate says gold bar maze. The lights are on all the time when it's exhibited and the image goes flash. And it's been, this is it hanging from the roof of Luke Gallery in Liverpool. It also hung from the roof in the Attica Centre in Leicester, and it was on tour in America, and it was at the Institute of Contemporary Arts in Michigan.